Hey, Coach, you guys have, kind of been working yourself out of a little bit of a rut, and then you had a wild week with Coach Muss and his situation. I'm just kind of curious how the last week has been for you individually, and then what have you made of the team's response during all this?
It's definitely been a next man up type of situation. I think that luckily, as we go through the summer and you prepare summer, spring, summer, and then the fall, you become so close that you're ready and prepared for these type of situations. Obviously, we never want to not have our head coach out there with us and our guys respond so well to him. But I thought it allowed us to grow. We had the Missouri game that really got us out of the hole. We played a great 40 minutes of basketball. And then to go from there and not have a hangover in some sense into LSU to play well there and to scrap a win out, and then to come home and not let down. Those three games have been a different situation. So we're really proud of the maturity. And now it's getting, trying to get another win and not take a step back.
And speaking of that, it hasn't even been 2 weeks since you played Texas A&M, but I think you guys probably feel like you're a different team now, and I'm sure they've evolved too. I'm curious what you've seen from Texas A&M in terms of growth. I'm sure you watched the Kentucky game last night.
And I think we probably all checked in on that a little bit. That was as good a game as you could have watched. The physicality, how tough they are, turning Kentucky over, 18 times like they did us, pressuring the ball. And it came down to the wire, in a great environment. So we definitely have seen the improvement of their team. Their ability to shoot the ball is something that's extremely frightening from three, right? They have a good percentage. Don't shoot as many as some other teams, but we know we have to take care of the ball. We have to continue to do a great job of rebounding the basketball, and then not allow them to get on the offensive glass. But they're a team that's extremely tough from watching them all year, and they're improving. Obviously, to play that well against a nationally ranked team, it's going to be a great environment on Saturday. We can't wait.
Touch.
Yeah, Coach, I'm curious what you thought about JD Notae and how he's evolved throughout the season.
Well, you could tell in the last game, I think that everybody watching him offensively, how hard he was driving the basketball. And that's something that for him to improve on, not just finding his teammates in pick and roll situations, but also trying to drive the ball, mix up his offensive game, try to get his efficiency up. And then I think when you see him on the ball, the way he jabs at the ball and pursues the basketball, not just going for steals. I know we all see the steals that he ends up getting, but I think if you see him fighting through screens, guarding one of their better perimeter players always, I couldn't be prouder of somebody. And he's really taking to Coach Muss's coaching in terms of, sharing the ball more, taking better shots, and then having to guard every single night. And that's something that I think happened last year at this time, that he really started to evolve into a defensive player. Now he's continuing to do that as a leader.
Bob?
Hey, I guess, how you doing? Good
We're
to
doing
see
great.
you. Hey, Stanley, I mean, we all know he could score. I guess he's probably close to 1,700 points at this point. But, he'd have some big scoring games. We ask Eric about him, and Eric would go like, yeah, he needs to rebound better, And I know the last two games he's gotten six each, which are pretty good numbers. And, of course, he had that huge offensive stick back at LSU when JD missed the free throw. That actually turned out pretty well for you guys. Just what do you thought about Stanley's rebound? And is that just something you guys told him, hey, if you want to get the minutes, you got to rebound? Or kind of how did all that evolve?
100%. I think the one thing that we all is your rebounding, especially at that position, whether it's the 3-4, even the 2 for Stanley at times, you have to get in there and mix it up. And I thought that the play that you just talked about, Bob, was one of the biggest ones of the year. His offensive rebound, that's something we had really worked on. We do a lot of drill work, and to see a drill, come into play in a game like that where, he makes an offensive rebounding move, gets in the paint and finishes it like that. That was so huge for him. And also, his teammates, their confidence in him. And I think that everybody knows he can score, but it's can he play in our defensive scheme? Can he rebound? And with his athleticism, I think that's why we challenge him so much, is because he has all that talent. He has those skills. So we're just trying to pull as much as we can. And when he rebounds, that's one or two offensive rebounds for him that he can get easy layup or a putback. And then we know his shot will be knocked down once he gets going defensively and rebounding. So he's been great to coach as well. And I think that's the fun part about this group, is we're still getting better. Like, we haven't plateaued. And it's exciting to see what we do against a team like A&M, who we've lost to and need to play better against.
Who had the scout against A&M the first time around? And when you play a team 2 weeks later, what's that scout like? You just update a few things, or because they're obviously,
Yeah, we're an information program. You know that. So we got to get, you know, the new stats and what are the new trends 3 games ago. Coach Smart had it last time. He has it this time again. He's actually down there getting the guys ready. So you're stuck with me, unfortunately. But sometimes, you know, with scouts, you lay it out that it might work this way. And then it gets changed. Maybe the next man up, you know, with certain situations. But also sometimes you have back to back. And I told Coach Smart, I'm like, hey, if I need to take one for you, you know, at any point, please let me know. He said, Gus, I was doing 82 games straight in the NBA as an assistant. So he wasn't too worried about it, to be honest with you. And sometimes that how it, you know, like I only had one scout so far in LSU. And then I have Ole Miss, and it's just kind of how the schedule lays out at times.
Well, that was a good, it turned out pretty well.
No and doubt.
It looked like, you know, when the other night, when the teams were down on the end on South Carolina's end, you know, Eric was up doing stuff. And then when they came the other way, he got backed off a little bit. It looked like you were kind of like the Secret Service guy ready to jump in and take a bullet or something if somebody was
trying to. Are you really trying to put that much pressure on me? I'm like, we needed a foxhole back there to protect. And somebody had said, I don't know if it was one of these calls last week, that Ronnie Brewer should have been up there to be the real wall. But yeah, Coach Smart and I were like, hey, we got to be careful here. If anybody comes through, it's going to be, we can't tackle another player. So hopefully it's one of our guys that's flying over here. But yeah, we were all on pins and needles. And I thought Coach, you know, with his toughness to be in there and be there with the team. And I think one thing that, you know, people forget in coaching, you're around your players so much, just like your family, that being away for 1, 2, or 3 days feels like, it's like dog years. It feels like a week. You know, when I go out recruiting and I'm gone and I miss a practice, when I came back, I feel like it's a different team. So especially as a head coach, having been there before, like you don't want to be away from your team. And I know Coach, you know, that's the most important thing, is helping us win.
And not that it's not great seeing you, but I hope this means Eric is still doing okay. Is the plan still for him to coach?
Yes.
Saturday night? Okay, good.
Yeah.
I got a couple more. I'll turn back over to Mike. Thanks, Gus.
For sure.
Scotty.
Hey Gus, I'm curious, what is something or some things that you've learned about this team in this kind of tale of 2-3 game runs in league play so far?
Well, I think we've learned a lot about lineups and who can play well together, where your shots need to come from, how resilient they are as players. Sometimes you think, well, this guy's been playing the 2 position, or he's been playing the 3 or the 4. But when you really sit down and you have to, you're forced to learn other positions and maybe guard differently. You know, we have Trey Wade on 1s, 2s, 3s, 4s, and 5s at times defensively. So you learn that players can do it. It's just really breaking it down and making it simple for them. We've learned, you know, one, that our rebounding travels with us. Our defense can travel with us. Also how hard it is for college players to be consistent. We felt like when we had played probably 90 minutes straight from Texas A&M second half until the start of the South Carolina game, we didn't feel like that 20 minutes that first half was our best. Was it our worst? No, but we just didn't have that fire that we had maybe those 90 minutes leading up to it. So it's always, you know, now that we have something, a standard to hold the guys to, and that standard has been lifted with each game. And I thought in the second half of South Carolina, now we set a new standard of how hard we can guard, you know. And then the other part of it is, to me as a coach watching this group, is how you can get the fans ignited with your play. And I think you've seen that in the last, you know, 2 home games, just the fans getting excited about young men playing super hard and getting excited. And I think that helps us a ton. But we continually are passing the ball. You know, we had over 250 passes in our last game. That's huge. Does it lead to a bunch of assists? Sometimes not, but I think we're taking better shots, and it shows how much you can improve as a team if you follow the game plan and keep developing.
And going back to Stanley for a minute, how do you feel like he's grown as a defender throughout the season? Because it feels like, especially lately, maybe in SEC play more than anywhere else, but he's, you know, being more disruptive pre-shot, maybe when guys are trying to take him off the dribble, and then he's kind of limiting his matchups to kind of tough shooting nights.
I think if you saw that last game, he had some deflections and blocked shots, you know, man on man. I thought in the ball screen, you know, their pick and roll action, he was really keeping it on his side and protecting the ball and not letting his man get by him. And I think 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, that was harder for him staying in the game. I think he's moving his feet better, and I think he's much more alert. And again, I can sense something in him on the defensive side, that he's aggressive. He's confident. He knows our scouts better than he has. He's really like taking on a role. And I thought that when we were going through our stretch of losing 3 in a row, the reason he came here, and I remember him saying this to me, was like, Coach, I came here to win big. and be on a winning program. So I could tell there was a sense of like, I don't want this to happen. And you can see that in his preparation, how hard he's playing, but he's really keeping the ball in front of him. He's not getting blown by. And I think in the beginning of the year, he was opening up his stance too much and he was getting beat off the balance, and he's doing a much better job of that.
And last thing for me, I'm curious if you're at liberty to say whether, you know, Kamani is, you know, getting closer to being able to get back with you guys.
Well, I wish I could look out there right now and say he's just doing 360 dunks and all that stuff, but he is getting better for sure. Not for sure what's going to happen on Saturday, but he's definitely getting better, not getting worse, which is a positive. And that's all I can give you as of right now, because we really don't know much more.
Nate?
Gus, just as far as Jalen Williams' offense, just kind of how has that evolved that he's become such an offensive force lately?
I think sometimes when you're unselfish, you know, good things come your way. You know, when you're a good person, you attract good things. It's kind of that karma. And he's such an unselfish teammate. He walks into practice wanting to be great. I think his teammates want him to succeed. You know, when you're like that, when you walk around, you pass the ball, people will pass the ball to you. I think the one thing that he's doing a better job of is making quick moves. He's not bouncing the ball when he catches in the paint. He's rolling harder and sealing harder. He's more decisive when he catches the ball, trying to have less turnovers. I think he was catching and thinking, you know, pass first every time. Now he's thinking, be a threat, make my man guard me, and then see what happens with the play. He's been putting in extra hours on his post work. I think in the beginning of the season, he was doing a little bit more perimeter shooting in practice, and that I think he's really mixed it up, working on his post moves, his perimeter shooting, his mid-range. And he's extremely confident. This is the most confident I've seen him. So for us, that's a great thing. He's going to rebound every game. He's going to defend, take charges. And now you're starting to see the ability to be a go-to guy at certain situations. And really, he's not forcing. He's taking what the defense gives him. Well, now teams are going to adjust to that. So I think it'll help us and open up more for us offensively if they're keying in on Jalen.
Has he been one of your easier guys to coach?
Oh, yeah. You can tell with players, and our team is extremely easy to coach. It'd be hard for me to lie on that one. We have really, really great young men. Jalen Williams is as easy as there is to coach. You know, you'll come in here after a game, he's in the training room. You'll walk in the weight room in here, he's laughing with you, joking with you. We were just in the weight room and there was some 80s music going on here. I forget who it was, but he was making fun of me that was my genre. So, I mean, he's just the type of guy that you want to be around. And for our team, he's evolving as a leader. We have kind of a group that's helping to lead this team. And I think he's one of the key parts of that. But, yeah, he's a joy to be around. He has great parents and great family.
Thank you.
Bob?
Hey, Gus, you know, the A&M game, you guys got off to a good start offensively, and Stanley was involved. And then he got foul trouble and fouled out with quite a bit of time left. How do you think that impacted you guys, and how big is it that he's been able to play, you know, pretty good minutes here of late during this winning streak?
We definitely got hot to start the game, and it was, you know, it's always a game of runs. There was a lot of runs in that game. If you go back and watch it, you know, how we started, how they fought back to end the first half, how, again, then they started the second half, how we finished the game. I think that anytime a player like Stanley gets in foul trouble, it definitely hurts you. You saw last game where JD and Jay Will got in foul trouble, and that affected us as a team. When Stanley's going, it's really easy to score because he can score it in the mid-range from three at the post. He can offensive rebound. So that helps us. It's an added bonus for our team. And a big piece of that is trying to get him. And this is something we talked about. I think Scotty asked a question, you know, defending without fouling. That's something he's gotten better at. At the same time, getting cheap ones, you know, getting off screens is something we got to focus on with him. You know, we want our turnovers to come or our fouls to come at the rim. You know, an offensive foul at the rim, trying to be aggressive. We don't want ticky-tack fouls that we can avoid. And we want Stanley playing as much as he can, you know. But one thing with Stanley is continuing to have great, you know, presence sprinting the floor on defensive transition. And if we see him getting tired, that's kind of when we think about taking him out and giving him a rest. But we don't want the referees and fouls calls to bring him out of the game.
And then you mentioned the leadership. You know, Stanley's an older guy, but of course he was a new guy too. And he came from South Dakota, you know, a fine program, but it's not like he came in from Duke or something. So,
right.
Do you see him taking on more of a leadership role?
Yeah, and I think that his leadership is to know what we do now and to be bought in 100% in that. That's how somebody like him comes into a program and leads, you know, and says, hey, guys, this is what we do. Jalen Williams has gone through the battles with coach. You know, Devo Davis has, JD has, Connor has. Now it's him saying, hey, I'm going to do whatever it takes to help us win. That's how he leads. And then somebody like a Trey Way does the same thing, a DC Tony, Chris Likes, that are new to the program. If they can buy in and step in line and do what's asked of them, do their job every game, then we have a great chance of winning. It's really that piece of it is, you know, not fighting it. Not that they were, but really just jumping in line and being 100% bought into, you know, the Arkansas way of playing basketball on offense and defense.
When JD had three blocks the other day, I was surprised. I think he's done that five times in his career, but this is from Hog Stats, who's got all the numbers. You know, but he'd never done against a major team like that. What'd you think? Because we don't, you think of JD doing a lot of things, but blocking shots and some that came to mind for me at least.
Yeah, that's not something that would just pop out. The steals, you know, one thing is when a player goes by our guys, we really teach them to rear contest, you know, to not give up on a play. So I think you'll see a lot of JD's coming from, you know, late closeouts, and he's pretty long and he's pretty sneaky athletic. So, you know, when he's, and that's another part of our team is multiple efforts. And you talked about it with Stan, you know, having a high hand, and JD now has even bought in more to that, and he's guarding great players. So your hand has to be up always. And if we can keep someone or, you know, catch somebody slipping and contest one late and get a block like that, I wouldn't expect a lot of games with JD getting three though. I hate to tell you that, Bob, he's probably not going to do that a ton because we're not a big time shot blocking team, even though we average what close to five, but he'll do that. And that's just another thing, whatever is needed of JD and J Will, Devo, they're doing that right now to help us win.
And then Eric, he was speaking to a luncheon deal before the season. I don't think you were there, but I'm not sure the context, but he said something like you keep him, like you crack him up at practice, or you make him laugh, or you keep him loose, or something to that effect.
Me?
That's what he said. Yeah. Just wondered, what's the key to making Eric laugh at a practice? Because I figure he's pretty intense, and you guys obviously go back a long way. Just is what I'm repeating making sense to you?
Yeah, for sure. You know, I will say this, part of having a great synergy as a staff, and I think our guys can feed off it, is we get along. You know, Coach Smart, Coach Moser, our whole staff gets along. Yeah, and I think that in a long season, we're around each other a lot. So there's a lot of funny things to pull from, especially right now when Coach is a little bit banged up. I'm going to try to get a couple smiles out of him before this thing gets going today. But yeah, you know, I try to keep it loose. I think we all have our different personalities. I think mine's one of, you know, just trying to be as upbeat, energetic as I possibly can with the guys. And I think that's one thing, like I said about the fans, this team right now is extremely fun to coach. Like they really are. And Coach Moss was telling them that the other day, you know, and they're messing around with Coach and saying stuff to him. And I think that, you know, as a program, like that's what you want. You want everybody enjoying being around each other, and it helps to win. But I think it also helps in how they're playing. I think that's why those students were so excited on Tuesday night, and hopefully they're the same way. But I'm gonna try my best, Bob, to get him to laugh and giggle. But when the tip, you know, when the game starts, you know, it's all business. So I just got to make sure that Coke doesn't spill like it did last game at Texas A&M.
Yeah. Well, okay. I missed that. I'm sorry.
What it was, I think it was A&M too. It did happen at A&M too. Yeah. So we've had a couple of Coke spills. So we're trying to make sure that doesn't happen.
Now, that was a tough game for turnovers all the way around, I guess. I just got one more. You know, you've been here a while now with your family. Obviously, I'm sure it's a lot different in Southern California or Reno for that matter. Just how do you and your family like living here? Just how's all that gone?
It's been phenomenal. I think the people always make the place. And our, you know, boys, Bo and Ace have met a bunch of great friends already. They have more sleep. They have like a whole social calendar already. So we got cotillion football games. So they're loving it. My wife has met a bunch of people, and obviously she had Danielle and a built-in crew here, but we're loving it. I would not lie to you though, that when I walked out of the house this morning, it felt a little bit different than Huntington Beach did at this time last year. The weather, it was a little bit cold, but I'm used to Reno, and Reno's pretty darn cold too. But it's been awesome. And like I said, beginning, like being able to coach in a program in a city that cares so much is something that's been like a dream come true for me. And again, we just want to keep it going the right direction. And like I said, there's a lot more smiles when you're, you know, on a 3-game win streak, but it's been fantastic, you know, overall for our family. So thanks for asking.
Hey, thanks. And, you know, just the key in the snow, just slow down. You know, it sounds simple. Just drive slower. That's the key. You know?
Yep, I got a truck. I handed in my little Jeep. I don't know what it was when I got here. Jeep Latitude, not that I didn't like it, and I traded in for a truck. So true Arkansas car right here, right? All weather.
Okay.
Thanks, Coach. Appreciate your time.
Thank you.